Hi friends, 3-4 days back, opposition party in India has asked the government that India's economic progress should not be seen through only through GDP growth rate, but we should start following the global misery index to understand the state of Indian economy. And many global economists have also supported this idea. What exactly is global misery index? This concept is not new. It was started in 1970s by one famous American economist, Arthur Okun. That time he developed this index based only on two factors, one on inflation, the other on unemployment rate. He used it specifically for US to calculate, because at that time in the 1970s, the world was going through oil crisis, a big oil crisis. So the prices of oil have increased so much that has hugely impacted on the American economy. That time US was importing oil. Now US is an exporter of oil and gas, particularly shale. So the global oil crisis of 1971 has impacted the economy. So he has developed this thing to understand how people are doing. But over the years, this particular index has seen a lot of changes and new factors have been added to make this index a much better one. And the latest one has been done in 2010 by another famous American economist who was working at that time with John Hopkins. His name is Mr. Hank. And that is now being used to rank various countries and see the progress what they are making. This particular global misery index uses four indices, four factors. The first is lending rate, the rate at which the banks lend it to the common customers. If the lending rates are high, then obviously there will be very few takers and naturally investment will come down. And second is unemployment rate. Naturally, if the economy is not doing well, then unemployment will also increase. The third is inflation. Of course, inflation, low inflation is a characteristic of developed economies, whereas moderate inflation is good for developing countries like India because that shows demand. Demand, if the economy is doing well, if employment is growing, if per capita incomes are growing, if disposable incomes are growing, then naturally inflation also will be there, moderate inflation. That is why the government has also given a target 4 ± 2% to RBI. So the inflation should be between 2 to 6%. I would say that strongly that inflation should be between 4 to 5% for a developing country like India, which shows there is a good demand, good consumption is growing. So these three factors, lending rate, unemployment rate and inflation, are added together. And then the fourth factor, that is GDP per capita growth, how much it has grown over 1 year, that rate is subtracted. So you get a raw score, and based on the score of different countries, different, they are ranked. So the 2019 report has come. This is based on 2018 data, has been released in October 2019. So this year 2019 report ranks 95 countries. The best is 95th one. It is specifically only based only on economic criteria. All these are economic criteria. Of course, misery is a much bigger thing that also depends upon political and social aspects also, that those are not taken into account. So 95th country has the lowest score. That means it is the best country to live. People are economic wise happy. Whereas number one is the worst country. So most of the countries in the bottom side of the index are from Latin America. The worst country is Venezuela. Of course, it is going through a lot of political problems between pro-US and anti-US groups. And since the anti-US groups, Mr. Maduro is the president, who is a leftist communist. So US has imposed huge sanctions on them. So inflation is skyrocketed, galloping inflation. So that is the basic reason why Venezuela is considered to be the worst country according to this index. Second is Argentina. Many of the South American countries are going through financial crisis. They are, even though their economies are reasonably good, their currencies have collapsed because there is a flight of all investment, FDI which has come can go anytime, FIIs particularly, the hot money flows has affected their economy, their exchange rates are down. So that is the reason Argentina is considered as the second worst country. Brazil was fourth. In between was Iran, which is also under Western sanctions after Trump withdrew from the nuclear deal, and therefore the prices have skyrocketed. And since the sanctions are targeting the most important export, oil and gas, unemployment rates are also high. Economy is also not growing that much. So Iran is third. So no surprises on all this. Turkey was fifth because this is also because it sent troops to Syria in the Kurdish areas. And there's a political issues between US and Turkey. So US has imposed some sanctions on Turkey. That is why Turkey is fifth. So, as I said, the bottom is not very surprising, but the top is very surprising. So, you may think that some Nordic countries may be in the top. No, it's Thailand. Because economy is growing well, unemployment rates are very low, inflation is very low, the tourist inflows are very good. So, people are enjoying the beaches of Pattaya, of course, prostitution, drugs and all that going on. So, Thailand is the number one country, even though politically people are miserable because Thailand is under military rule for the past 2-3 years. And last 15 years or so, it has been on and off military rule, and it is a complete despotic regime which denies some of the basic rights to the common man. Japan is the third best country, probably no surprises there. But the big surprise is China is fifth best country, much higher. US is somewhere around 22nd or 23rd. UK is still further behind. France is further behind. Sweden is somewhere in the top 10 among the Nordic countries. But imagine China, which we say is a totalitarian state, a communist state, and is in top 5, fifth country, the best country in the world. So that I sold that because it doesn't take into account the political factors. It takes or the suppression, the despotic regime, the denial of rights and all that. Only economic criteria, lending rate, unemployment rate, inflation and GDP per capita income growth rate. So these are the only four factors considered. Now coming to India, what is the position India occupies? India's position is 44th out of the 95 countries, exactly somewhat in the middle position India is occupying. So India's misery index has been increasing in the last 2 years. And when this last data was given in October 2019, which is based on 2018 data, India's rank was 44 out of 95 countries. That has taken inflation at 3%. Now, I posted one video last week. Inflation for the month of December has crossed 6%. Overall, inflation also is expected to be 5.5 to 6% for the financial year. But this was taken for the 2018 overall data. So, inflation was only 3% at that time. Unemployment rate was taken as 3%. Now, of course, that is also hugely increasing. I posted a Facebook video again around 10-15 days back on that. Lending rates were taken at 10% by this report. Lending rates have slightly come down to around 9.25-9.5% because RBI has been continuously reducing the repo rates. So some marginal reduction has taken place. Whereas on the subtraction side, that is GDP per capita income growth rate, this report takes it at 7%. But now even the government says that the GDP growth rate for this fiscal year, ongoing fiscal year, will be 5%. But when we higher inflation means per capita income growth rate will be much lower. So when you put all that, India probably now, if it is for the report for 2020, when it is released later this year, probably India's rank will be somewhere around 70s out of 95 countries. So that is the reason opposition parties say that we should take this index into account. But after this demand was made and it was the newspapers reported it, Hanke, who himself who was the person who authored this particular index, so himself has tweeted that yes, this is the right way to calculate or see the progress or decline of a country's economy. So I completely agree. He also tweeted that the government claims of 5% growth rate, GDP growth rate this year is completely false. It will be much, much lower than that, which I have been saying it also for the past few. I've been saying that I expect the growth to be somewhere around 0.5 to 1% only. The reason being the way it is calculated, GDP is calculated, has been changed, and a lot of fudging of accounts or cheating our accounts is also going on. So in effect, it will be very low. And unemployment rates are 45-year-old high. And inflation is growing up. I said that that also depends upon the Gulf crisis and all that. Also, oil prices also important. Even though oil is stable at around $65 per barrel, you never know what is going to happen. And of course, it also depends upon the monsoon. If monsoon rains well, again, food prices will go up. Again, already food prices are pretty high, particularly vegetables, dal, pulses are very high. So it could be pushed up, even cereals will go up if after that all we have to see that once IMD comes up with the forecast. And lending rates, as I already said, there is very little scope for RBI to reduce the lending rates further because that will have an impact on inflation and growth also. So probably RBI has put the pass button now after reducing it for 5 consecutive times since 2018. So this is not a good sign for the economy. The budget has also come and hardly any measure has been announced in the budget to boost the economy. Again, vague promises. That is the reason why Sensex fell down by almost 1000 points the day immediately after the budget was budget speech was made. So that's still that the problem is, as I keep saying, there is no coordinated measures. There has to be political will. Enough attention has to be given. A combined fiscal and monetary policies are needed. Huge investment is needed. So, because in this index also doesn't take into account fiscal deficit. Only inflation, lending rates are taken into account. There is hardly, you know, Mr. Hank in his tweet said the outlook for India is going down like anything. The confidence in India has gone down completely. So that is the reason investments, global investments are also coming, not coming. So Indian investments anyway are not coming, the domestic investments, and even profit making companies are feeling the heat. That's the reason why tax collections are so low. So again, pushing down the pushing up the fiscal deficit and affecting the ability of the government to spend public investments, public expenditure. So nothing looks well for the economy as things stand now.
Okay.